Okay, next in the Surface setup, we're gonna be doing the Preferences tab. Now there's two ways to access the preferences. On either side of the screen, we can go ahead here and hit the home button and bring ourselves into the general preferences tab. Okay, or the other way, which is using our quick access buttons here next to the automation section, by double tapping on this second to the last button here, and that'll bring us into the preferences tab. Okay, in the preferences screen, the first thing that we're gonna find, the tab here, is configuration. Okay, the first item below that is the sync source. This is a digital console, so everything needs to be on one clock, so everything is working all in the same clocking format. So as you see right now, the sync light is illuminated green. It just tells you that everything attached to the console is operating on in sync. Okay, next below that, we have the active source for selecting the primary and secondary, you know, where to get the clock from. You could have it selected for automatic, so that way the console will just pick it off. Personally, I just like to leave this off because I just want to have the stage word clock, which is the clock in the neutron. And then if we were to lose that, the secondary would then be the internal inside here on the Surface. Next over here, we have the master and slave status. Right now, because I'm only using one Midas Pro Series, this is the master console. If I was using a second Pro Series console, or even an M32, and we wanted to share the IO boxes together, we would have to send one of those to slave. So next below here, we have the DSP timeout. So for me personally, just leave this set to infinity and you never have to mess with this, okay? Next below this is our connections. These are our HyperMAC connections. We have a redundant and a main, okay? This is our X line and our Y line, okay? These consoles can do copper, which is our standard Cat5e cable, or we could use multi-mode fiber cables. Right now I have both of these selected to copper because I have two Cat5 cables connected. You could do one and one or any combination, you know, whatever you want. If you want to go have an extra layer of protection, which I have done from time to time, is I'll be running fiber and copper at the same time. In the event if I lost one, I can easily switch in here and switch them over. One very important thing, one little note I want to point out, is when you do a firmware update on the console, the console will automatically default back to fiber connections. I had a lot of people call me when they do a firmware update. Hey, I turned the console back on, but I'm not getting connectivity to the console. I tell them, hey, go here and check this. And sure enough, it switched over to fiber and everything was working once they switched it back to copper. So just keep that in mind. If you do a firmware update, you will need to jump back in here and select that. Below is the fan speed. All right, this is for the Surface, for the internal cooling fans. Right now I have it set to slow, not in a really, really heated condition, so I'm leaving in slow. I've done some pretty hot shows and always left it in slow. I never had a problem, never had a warning light to say, hey, things are overheating. So the slow speed has definitely been effective for me. Next here, we're gonna have the 431 and the 231 mic splitters. Okay, those IO boxes allow you to have separate gain controls. So if you are using two consoles, it would allow me to select to say, hey, here, this Surface here at front of house, I want to use the A ones. And then over in monitors, you're going to use the B ones. And we have complete independent control. Next below that is the date and time. Go ahead and click that. It'll bring it up. You know, we could use standard time, military time, daylight savings time, and then the date. Very easy, straightforward, to the point. So that way when you're looking at the automation screen, you will see that the information's right here and it's showing that. Okay, so let's go back to preferences. Okay, below is the playback for the input source. Because I'm gonna be using virtual sound check, it's coming off of my recording, I'm gonna need those inputs coming back in on the tape return. So this is just the global selection to say, hey, when I'm in virtual playback, I'm taking all of my inputs from the tape returns. So this also defaults to normal. So make sure you go ahead and select that. It has caught me in the past. So just a reminder to pass that on to you. When you do want to do virtual sound check, and we're going to get into that in more detail, this is where you would go ahead and change all the inputs from the mic gains. So we'll go ahead and take a look at that. where I have the mic gains, as you see there on the left side of the console. If I go ahead and select the tape returns, you'll see that they all went away. And if you're done with your virtual sound check, you can disable them all. So this is a very quick and easy way to do that. Below, we have the defaults. So this will restore the default preferences of the console, and then this will restore all the globals of the console. Not something you have to do, but if for some unknown reason you wanted to go ahead and completely zero the board and all of the settings and the preferences and everything on the console, then you can go ahead and do that. But personally, I've never gone to that, so we'll just skip and move on. Next is the remote control section. This is for connecting like a router to the console, the control with an iPad. We're gonna have a separate video where I'm going into how to configure that and set that up to use the iPad and have the software. So we'll get into that further. Below here, a lot of people ask me this, it's like Bay ID, what is this telling me? Well, there's two computers on the 3, 6, and 9 and the ProX console. So right now, the main computer that's running on the console is MC1, which stands for Master Controller. So that's telling me that MC1 is active. Okay, if I was to switch over, this side of the desk would then be illuminated. Okay, let's move on. We're gonna jump back into the show tab, which we saw in an earlier video. This is how you're gonna basically configure the desk as far as your effects and your graphic EQs. Like I leave this set for 22 effects and 8 graphic EQs. This is more than what I need to do for a front of house mix. But some of you guys out there may be doing monitors from front of house where you need more graphic EQs and you don't need as many effects. So this gives you the options. And as you see, you know, you can get 36 graphic EQs. So you can definitely get a lot of graphics out of this console. If you surround sound guys want to go ahead and set your console up for surround, this is where you're going to go. To set that up, you have your quad, your LCRS, and your 5.1, okay? The automate patching is basically, you know, for any of the recalling, so you can automate any of your patching in and out as you go from scene to scene. Next is the user tab. A lot of information on this screen. You know, I do, every time I walk up to a console, you know, I pretty much kind of go here after setting the console up. I like to have the console set up in a specific way. We can load and store presets. Once again, I'm going to have a separate video on how to do that, but just to touch really quickly on that. You know, you could store all of your presets. So if you are going from console to console every day and, you know, you're not carrying your own, you could bring your show files as well as your preset files, and you can quickly load it and then bring in your configuration and it'll load right up as opposed to having to go through and double check and make sure that everything is selected. But again, we'll be going over that in a separate video on how to make that file, how to save it and create one and export it. Okay, so now we're in the user tab. All right, this is for the user interface. This is basically gonna be how the control surface is gonna react during the show, you know, how you want it to set the console up for your workflow. So the first tab that's selected there is the display rotary values. What that basically means, so if we have a channel selected right here, so we'll just select channel 20. As I, you know, put my finger on any of the EQ tabs, you can see on the screen the numbers are reflecting. So as we go through, we could boost the EQ. Let's go ahead and turn that on there. And you see the gain numbers, same thing with the frequency. That applies to any, you know, section that we're in, if we're in the comp, gate, whatever. As we're turning any of these controls, we're visually seeing the numbers appear on the screen. Personally, it's something that I like, and it makes life easier, particularly like, you know, when you're using the filters and stuff like that. You can see where you're rolling the frequencies off, okay? Next, the fast zone delay control. Okay, if we select this, as I showed you earlier, okay, with the gain swap, right now this is putting the controls for all of the analog head amps like on the screen. So if we swap that, now we have the digital trim knobs, okay? So if we have the fast zone delay control selected, we go ahead and press this again, that's gonna now bring the input delay to the encoders here on the top of the channel strips. Just so you know, this is delay, more of time alignment. This is not like, you know, effect delay, like repeats on a vocal or anything like that.
A great way to use this would be with a bass guitar, like if you're putting a microphone as well as a DI box on the bass, the DI signal is going to show up slightly ahead of the microphone. So you can go ahead and add a little bit of delay to the DI, and it's going to then slow that down so that way the microphone lines up at the same time, and then both those signals are in phase. It's a great thing to do. I use it a lot. Channel delay is excellent. So this will allow you to have it right there at the top. Personally, it's not something that I'm using all the time, keeping it there, but you might find a situation where that's helpful for you. So this is an option. So we'll go ahead and deselect that. Okay, input select follows the solo. So what that means, like right now, I have channel 20 selected, as you can see that on the left side of the screen. So if I went over to solo channel 16, you'll see that now 16 is showing up as well. So if I go to 13, that's there, vice versa. So as I start soloing, it's always gonna bring that channel up to the selected view. I leave that off. It's not something I'm using. I'm not really soloing a lot of channels. Same thing here with the output. So if I need to select, you know, say for example, matrix 7, that's gonna select the channel automatically and bring it up into the view. Next that I have highlighted is the automate paging. I love this feature. This is really, really a cool function, okay? Say for example, you're doing automation, you have song 1. For song 1, you need channel 17, which is say the bass guitar, okay? And you know that once you enter that song, you're gonna need to be in the EQ view to make some changes there. So once you store it and you come into that song, so now every time you go into that automation for that scene, it's gonna select that channel, it's gonna have the EQ automatically showing up on the screen so you can get right to that control immediately. You know, same thing with the gate, the compressor, the pan, like any parameter that you need selected will automatically select that channel and that, you know, function on the console. Really, really helpful, you know, in my workflow. Next is touch navigation of the detail area. Basically what that means is, if I touch, say, because right now we have the compressor area highlighted. Now, if I want to go ahead and go down to the EQ section, just by me putting my fingers on any one of the EQ buttons, it's going to automatically bring that view. Same thing with the master, the gate, or the compressor, or, you know, the gains, or anything like that. Very, very easy. And super awesome and smooth for the workflow. Okay, one thing to keep in mind though, you know, if you accidentally maybe hit a knob, like as you're moving, you know, just be conscious that, you know, it's gonna change the screen and put you in a different area. Next, global meters pre as a tap button. Okay, as we see here on the surface, this is flashing. This is what I'm using for my tap. As you'll notice, the tempo up in the top right portion of the screen is changing as I'm using this. If this was deselected, you'll see that it stops, okay? So that allows us to keep our tap right there. And following that, the flash global continuously is exactly what it says. It's constantly leaving the tap meter going. I like it on, if we had it off, so we tap our tempo, it'll flash for a little bit, and then eventually then it stops and goes away, just as you see there, okay? Next, we have collapse, flip, hide unassigned channels. The lingo is a little confusing, it was for me at first, but this is a really, really awesome feature. I know that these videos are mostly for front of house and stuff, but monitor guys would love this. But for me, I like it for the effects. So for example, what this does is, say we have aux send 1, or let's use 3, okay? So we have aux send 3. Let's say that that's gonna be our drum reverb. So now, let's select aux send 3. So channels, let's see. Channels 1, we'll say 1 through 8 are gonna be all of our drums, and we wanna have all of those ready to go for the reverb. So now if we go into fader flip, okay, to send levels to, you know, the drum reverb, I just select this, flip it, and with collapse flip selected, The only channels that are gonna appear here in the fader flip mode are just those channels that are associated with that effect send. So you have to make sure that the mix button is engaged for that send, and then that's what's gonna bring it. So to show you for an example, let me take out number 8. So let me come out of fader flip mode. All right, let me turn mix 8 off. So let's flip that back for aux send 3. Now it's gone. So really awesome for, you know, especially if you have 144 inputs going and, you know, you got channels 1 to 10 and 29 and 54 and 87, instead of trying to page through to get to all of those channels, it's just going to show you anything that's associated with that mix. So that makes your life really, really easy to be able to make changes in a fader flip motion. So I would definitely suggest bringing that into your workflow. It's going to save you a lot of time, and it just makes life really, really easy. Okay, next, outputs on the input bay. As we scroll through earlier, you'll see here, all right, we have all 144 inputs, and then you get all the aux returns. You do not get any of the aux sends nor the matrixes because you have them here in front of you. But if you want to have them down here for whatever reason, if you go ahead and select this, now this is going to bring your matrixes. So as I scroll back, you'll see matrixes are popping up, and now all the aux sends are there as well. Okay, so that's what outputs on input bay. Next, we have the fader flip section. This is going to basically can run the console, you know, how you want the fader flip mode to operate. As you see here on the screen, we have two options, flip the faders or flip the pans. I like to leave the console set to flip to faders. So let's go ahead and select aux send 1 and 2, which I have already configured to be a stereo aux send. We'll go into a video later on in more depth on how to do that. But for now, this is already configured for this example. So right now, we select aux send, we select fader flip. Now we're in fader flip mode. And now as you see, as I'm bringing up the fader, you'll see there on the overview screen that the level is going up and down, like it's supposed to. The pan knob now is going to control the send to, you know, whether you want it to go to the left ear or the left side reverb or whatever it is that you need, you know, for the stereo image, just by turning the pan knob. So let me come out of that for a second. All right. So now flip to pans. What that's going to do is it's going to take away all of the options for the fader. So let's go ahead, and you see that the fader now is not reacting at all to the send level. It's put all the level now on the pan knob. So if you notice on the screen, everything went hard left to denote infinity. All right, so now as I bring this up, you'll see now that this is the level control. Personally, I don't know why you would use that. I personally like the fader flip, or maybe that's just my traditional mode, but it's an option that's there for you. Okay, let me go ahead and put that back to the way I like it. And now, sync area B. Basically what that means, because this console can be split into dual user, if it's synced to area B, if you have complete control on the left side, or opposed to the right side where they're independent, but if you have this selected, sync to area B, this will fader flip the right side of the console. Very simple and straightforward to the point. Below that now is the VCA unfolding, okay? Once again, I'm gonna just quickly set this up right now. I'm just gonna select a few channels to assign it to our first VCA. So we'll do 1 and 2, 7 and 8. Once again, I'll go over this later on. So we see here, these are all mono channels and independent. So let me go ahead and just link these two really, really quick. So as you see, as I hit the link button to make this two channels, it separated it down to have the stereo channels showing up on one fader. And with the link options and stuff, which I'm gonna get into later on, it's all gonna control everything. You don't have to worry about needing two faders and taking up the space. Something I use a lot and saves a lot of space on the console. Below that's the name list. It's another way that you can get into the naming window. So if we go ahead and select that, you'll see that we have like everything listed up here. okay? Like for our different names. All right, on scene store is overwrite the safe parameters. Basically what that means is if there's anything safed out on the console, you know, when we store it, it's just gonna override it. Very simple, straightforward, to the point. All right, virtual sound check record. All right, once you kind of set this, it's pretty much, you know, ready to go. The first tab, all direct outputs, pre-processing. Basically what that means is it's gonna pick the audio off right after the head amp, okay? So you'll have signal coming in, and then the direct out will go to your recording source. It's so none of the EQ or, you know, any of the dynamics are gonna be affected by that. You can change that if you want to. As you see here, like right now, it's selected that the pickoff point is just after the input. So if I wanted to change it, we could have it coming in after the processing, or have it, you know, hard. Like if you want to commit to the EQ, the processing, and the fader levels while you're mixing, that's an option, you know, for you. So you could do that. So if I go ahead and select this tab, and you'll see that it brings it all back. So typically this is what you're gonna wanna do. You're gonna want your inputs all pre-processing. It makes life easier for your virtual sound check. The next tab is unmute all direct outs. So as we get into the patching, and I show you how to patch in the recording, and then you're ready to keep, you know, your direct outs unmuted, so that way you have signal going to your record. Instead of going to every single individual channel, which will take you a year and a day, you can just go ahead and press this tab. It's gonna unmute everything. Same thing with the mute below that. You can mute all the direct outs, very simple and to the point. Lastly with that, setting all your direct output gains to zero. So as you see here on the left-hand side, the direct output is set right now to infinity, basically, which is off. And if I hit select all gains to zero, you see that it brings the knob back up to zero and everything's great. So the level in is gonna be the exact level out. Okay, next we have the metering. This is very simple and straightforward to the point. This has to do with, you know, the peak hold times of the meters, how, you know, the meter attack is, the meter delay, and the decay time of the metering. I leave it in the default. It's just personally how I like to do it, okay? Next, we're gonna get into the illumination, okay? The screen brightness, okay? If you wanna make the screens brighter, then you just simply just tab on this. One thing I do need to point out though, this is only gonna work for the right side screen. So if you wanna change the left side screen, you would have to go into the preferences tab over here and go ahead and go into user and make your adjustments there. The light bar, that will work on either. So it's not the one side. So that's global for the entire lighting bar. The lighting bar would be the light just underneath the screens there, okay? And same thing, you can change how bright you have the meters and everything on the console. If you like it nice and dark, you can bring all that down. If you like it nice and bright, like maybe if you're outside, vice versa, you know, it gives you the options. Okay, next we're gonna go into the linking tab. All right, I briefly mentioned how we can link channels and how things react. This is the global configuration for how the linking option is going to be. You could go in on a channel by channel basis and individually select things of how, you know, what you want to react on that channel, or you could do it globally. So if you have input channels or aux returns or sends, matrices, masters, whatever it may be, you could have it set up so that way it automatically is going to react the way you want it to. So if you're constantly doing the same thing on every linked channel, this is where you'd want to go. Okay, so again, personally, this is something that I like to set up ahead of time because I know that I always like to share certain things, especially like the mutes and the solos on some things, but I don't like it on the master, so that way I can check the masters like independently to make sure that I actually am connected to the left side or the right side and vice versa. And you'd be surprised, that happens a lot. So I would suggest maybe leaving the mute and the solo off there. But very straightforward to the point. I don't feel I have to get very much involved here. Everything is laid out there on the screen. Now down on the bottom there, the chains existing, okay? If you've already started working on the console and you're like, oh, you know, it's like, okay, for this band, it's like, I really wanna make all of these link channels to do this. And you've already kind of done some things and you wanna move forward. If you go ahead and you make a change here, if you do change existing, it's gonna then apply it now to all of those link channels that you've already made based under the tab that you selected. So input channels that were already made will be changed. If you did it to aux returns, invite, you know, and so on and so forth. Okay, now the last tab is the delay compensation. One very, very important thing that I want to talk about the Midas Pro Series consoles is delay compensation. What that means, because this is a digital console, you got signal coming in and signal leaving the console, okay? Then there's internal routing, okay? So say, for example, you have, say, channel one, you know, is a kick drum, and channel six is like a vocal, okay? If you have the vocal being processed by like a compressor that's inserted, the kick drum channel is going to get to the left and right before the vocal. Why? Because the vocal needs to get processed through those effects. You got to remember, this is a digital console and there's a computer and the audio has to get processed. So if the audio is arriving at different times and it's leaving the desk, it's going to sound very strange and very, very weird. Okay? So what Midas has done is it's done onboard delay compensation. It's calculating all of the delay that it needs to add to these channels, so that way every signal that's passing through this console is gonna leave the left and right or any of the sends all at the same time, so everything is properly at time aligned and it's sounding great. But here we have a couple of presets. This is suggested settings. So if you have just like a front of house mix, if you were to press that button, it's gonna go ahead and select the options that it's recommended to be using for that. If you go ahead and select low latency, once again, it's gonna go ahead and put defaults in there for what's suggested. Same thing with monitor mix. And monitor mix low latency, okay? Or you can go ahead and select everything yourself. So we have input channels, basically means that the console is gonna now take into consideration that it has to add delay compensation whenever you have anything inserted on the console, whether that be an internal effect or a hardware piece, okay? Next below that, we have for the aux sends, okay? This is gonna do the same thing. This is gonna make sure that everything like in the aux sends is all in time with everything else, so everything is lining up. Basically, I would suggest you just leave everything set, so let the console do all the work for you and you don't have to think about it. Same thing with the master and the matrix, very, very important stuff to do. Lastly, I want to talk about master to matrix post-processing and give you a little story on what happened to me, and I've had a few people reach out to me about this. Personally, I like mixing left and right. In some situations when I have to do, say, subs on an aux or delays like front fills and stuff like that, I like to feed those matrices off of the left and right bus. It just makes my life easier, okay? As you saw, I have the hardware insert, the Max BCL, that's inserted on the master left and right, and it has the Max Bass function on there. So all of the low end processing, there was a day like, and I was like, I had subs on an aux, and I'm like, this sounds really, really strange. Like, I can't get the subs right. Like, something's going on. It's like, is it not time aligned? Ultimately, what was ended up happening was the left and right was being processed by the Max BCL, but the sub send was not getting processed by anything. So the sub level was actually ahead of the left and right signal. So my master fader leaving the console going to the main PA was actually behind in time. And I stumbled across this one day because I had a very shallow stage. And so I wanted to delay the PA to the stage bleed. And as I was adding delay to the left and right, the subs kind of came into image and I'm like, what's going on? And I had that aha moment because I did not have that processed. So if you're gonna be feeding anything, inserting anything off of your left and right, I would suggest you go ahead and select master to matrix post-processing, because now everything that's leaving the console is gonna have that, you know, that dynamics and also EQ. So if you have a graphic EQ, that's gonna, you know, apply to, you know, those zones as well. So that's one very, very important tip.